guys. Well, it was bad enough. In fact, current estimates are that, well, you know, they vary. I mean, the CIA claim 50 to 100,000 people killed, and maybe another million or so who died one way or another. Michael Vickery, as one person's given a really close, detailed analysis, his figure is maybe 750,000 deaths above the normal. Others, like Ben Kiernan, suggest higher figures, but so far without a detailed analysis. Anyway, it was terrible, no doubt about it. Although the atrocities, the real atrocities, were bad enough, they weren't quite good enough for the purposes needed. Within a few weeks after the Khmer Rouge takeover, the New York Times was already accusing them of genocide. At that point, maybe a couple hundred or maybe a few thousand people had been killed. And from then on, it was a drumbeat, a chorus of genocide. The big bestseller on Cambodia, Pol Pot, is called Murder in a Gentle Land. Up until April 17, 1975, was a gentle land of peaceful, smiling people. And after that, some horrible Holocaust took place. Very quickly, a figure of 2 million killed was hit upon. In fact, what was claimed was that the Khmer Rouge boast of having murdered 2 million people. Facts are very dramatic. In the case of atrocities committed by the official enemy, extraordinary show of outrage. Exaggeration, no evidence required, faked photographs are fine, anything goes. Also, vast amount of lying. I mean, an amount of lying that would have made Stalin cringe. It was fraudulent, and we know that it was fraudulent by looking at the response to comparable atrocities for which the United States was responsible. Early 70s Cambodia, Timor, two very closely paired examples. Well, the media response was quite dramatic.
Back in 1980, I taught a course at Tufts University. Well, Chomsky came around to this class. He made a very powerful case that the press underplayed the fact that the Indonesian government annexed this former Portuguese colony in 1975. And that if you compare it, for example, with Cambodia, where there was acreage of things, that this was a communist atrocity, whereas the other was not a communist atrocity. Well, I got quite interested in this, and I went to talk to the then deputy foreign editor of the Times. And I said, you know, we've had very poor coverage on this. And he said, you're absolutely right. There are a dozen atrocities around the world that we don't cover. This is one for various reasons. So I took it up.
I was working as a reporter and writer for a small alternative radio program in upstate New York, and we received audio tapes of interviews with Timorese leaders. And we were quite surprised that given the level of American involvement, that there was not more coverage, indeed practically any coverage, of the large-scale Indonesian killing in the mainstream American media. We formed a small group of people to try to monitor the situation and see what we could do over time to alert public opinion to what was actually happening in East Timor.
There were literally about half a dozen people who simply dedicated themselves with great commitment to getting the story to break through. And they reached a couple of people in Congress. They got to me, for example. I was able to testify at the UN and write some things. They kept at it, kept at it, kept at it. Whatever is known about the subject is mainly comes from, essentially comes from their work. There's not much else.
I wrote first an editorial called An Unjust War in East Timor. It had a map, and it said exactly what had happened. We then ran a dozen other editorials on it. They were read, they were entered in the Congressional Record, and several congressmen then took up the cause, and then something was done in Congress as a result of this.
The fact that the editorial page in the New York Times on Christmas Eve published that editorial put our work on a very different level. And it gave a great deal of legitimacy to something that we were trying to advance for a long time, and that was the idea and the reality that a major tragedy was unfolding in East Timor.
If one takes literally the various theories that Professor Chomsky puts out, one would feel that there is a tacit conspiracy between the establishment press and the government in Washington to focus on certain things and ignore certain things, so that if we broke the rules, that we would instantly get a reaction, a sharp reaction from the overlords in Washington, who would say, hey, what are you doing speaking up on East Timor? We're trying to keep that quiet. We didn't hear a thing. What we did hear, and this was quite interesting, is that there was a guy named Arnold Cohn, and he became a one-person lobby.
I appreciate the nice things that Karl Meyer said about me in his interview, but I object to the notion that a one-man lobby was formed or anything like that. I think that if there weren't a large network composed of the American Catholic Bishops Conference, composed of other church groups, composed of human rights groups, composed of simply concerned citizens and others, and a network of concern within the news media, I think that it would have been impossible to do anything at all at any time, and it certainly would have been impossible to sustain things for as long as they've been sustained.
Professor Chomsky and a lot of people who engage in this kind of press analysis have one thing in common. Most of them have never worked for a newspaper. Many of them know very little about how newspapers work.
Dr. Davis, telephone.
When Chomsky came around, he had with him a file of all the coverage in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and other papers of East Timor. And he would go to the meticulous degree that if, for example, the London Times had a piece on East Timor, and then it appeared in the New York Times, that if a paragraph was cut out, he'd compare and he'd say, look, this key paragraph right near the end, which is really what tells the whole story, was left out of the New York Times version of the London Times thing.
There was a story in the London Times, which is pretty accurate. The New York Times revised it radically. Didn't just leave a paragraph out. They revised it and gave it a totally different cast. It was then picked up by Newsweek, giving it the New York Times cast. It ended up being a whitewash, whereas the original was an atrocity story.
So I said to Chomsky at the time, I said, well, it may be that you're misinterpreting ignorance, haste, deadline pressure, etc., for some kind of determined effort to suppress an element of the story.
He said, well, if it happened once or twice or three times, I might agree with you. But if it happens a dozen times, Mr. Meyer, I think there's something else at work.
And it's not a matter of happening one time, two times, five times, 100 times. It happened all the time.
I said, Professor Chomsky, having been in this business, it happens a dozen times, that these are very imperfect institutions.
When they did give coverage, it was from the point of view of, it was a whitewash of the United States. Now, you know, that's not an error. That's systematic, consistent behavior, in this case, without even any exception.
This is a much more subtle process than you get in the kind of the sledgehammer rhetoric of the people that make an A to B equation between what the government does, what people think, and what newspapers say. That sometimes what the Times does can make enormous difference. At other times, it has no influence whatsoever.
So one of the greatest tragedies of our age is still happening in East Timor. The Indonesians have killed up to a third of the population. They're in concentration camps. They conduct large-scale military campaigns against the people who are resisting. Campaigns with names like Operation Eradicate or Operation Clean Sweep. Timorese women are subjected to a forced birth control program. In addition, they're bringing in a constant stream of Indonesian settlers to take over the land. Whenever people are brave enough to take to the streets in demonstrations or show the least sign of resistance, they just massacre them. is sort of like Indonesia. If we allow them to continue to stay in East